My topic is metacognition. And you might wonder, well, what is metacognition? It's a fancy sounding word, but what does it mean? It's got a very simple definition. It's just thinking about thinking, nothing more really. It's a very broad category. Really, this is what we're dealing with here is the problem of other minds. Each one of us knows one mind from the inside. And we use that knowledge of our own mind to extrapolate to trying to know other people's minds. It's a natural process, really. People generally naturally come to an understanding of other people's minds, and we can see when this doesn't work. Some people are affected by autism. That's sometimes called mind blindness because they don't have a natural ability to understand or pay attention to other people's minds. So it's really a natural thing for people to be metacogs. Now, us skeptics are really, this is a topic that we have a particular interest in because we really want to know our own minds. We want to understand other people's minds, understand how we think and the flaws in people's thinking so that we can avoid them. This idea of metacognition is something that's really a key for skeptics. We can understand each other's minds using a form of analogy, but we have a hard time identifying with minds that aren't like our own. For example, if other non-human animals, we really can't extrapolate our experience with our consciousness to understand their consciousness. So this has limits. It's more serious than you might expect because not only do we have a problem with understanding other people's minds, we have a problem trying to understand our own mind because there's a limit to how much we can introspect and know our own mind because our conscious part of our mind is rather limited. It's just a small part of our entire mind. There's a part that we, by definition, can't reflect on. That's the subconscious. By definition, we really can't access consciously that part of our mind, which is the subconscious, and it actually might be the majority of our mind. So it's something to take into account. I'm going to be talking about a set of topics which I think will inform the topic of metacognition, but it's sort of a random assortment of different things. So let me get into it right away. The first topic is brain evolution. You might think that because evolution is such a long process, that perhaps our minds are finely tuned because it's been taking hundreds of millions of years to get to this point. So you might think, oh, you know, we must be excellent at reasoning because of this long process. Well, maybe not. There's a great book by Gary Marcus called Kludge, and something that engineers, computer scientists use this term kludge all the time, meaning an inelegant solution to a problem, something that works but it's very inelegant, and I think that's applicable to the human mind. You can see the evolutionary history if you look deeply in the brain. There's a core that we share with other animals like reptiles. So this is what Gary calls the progressive overlay of technologies. And that's really true, I think, for the mind. It's a good book. I recommend it. He gives a good example of this, not for brain evolution, but rather the evolution of the eye, where he makes the point that we have some really interesting deficiencies in our own eye because the retina faces backwards. All vertebrates have a retina which faces the back of the eye, the light-sensitive cells. There's intervening structures like nerves and such that reduce the eye's sensitivity. So this is an obvious problem. Now, this is something that early in evolutionary history, the retina was inverted like this, perhaps because it was an outgrowth of the brain. And this is something that evolution never corrected. It's a deficiency, and that results in also having a blind spot in each eye because where the nerves exit the eye, that's an area that's not light sensitive. So we have two blind spots as a result. Now, that's not true of cephalopods like octopuses. They have a retina that faces forwards. And they don't have a blind spot. You know, just an accident of evolutionary history that we stuck with this suboptimal structure. This might be true of the brain, too. Maybe there's lots of things about our brain which are suboptimal. It's something that was decided early on in evolutionary history and never corrected. I guess we have to ask ourselves when we're thinking about evolution and the brain, what are brains for? Why does evolution produce brains? It's for very basic things. And we call it the four Fs. The four Fs are fighting, fleeing, feeding, and reproduction. Some very basic things. And it's surprising that we have these minds that are capable of abstract symbolic reasoning when really all we need to do is these four things, really. In fact, you can see where advanced cognitive capability might be a liability. If you're sitting thinking when you should be fleeing, you know, you might be lunch. There's a good reason why we might suspect that speed is important. It's important to be fast. And not necessarily accurate, but fast is important. And that, we'll come to that later. Now, I also want to switch from evolution to other topics in anatomy. For example, the brain is divided very distinctly into two halves, the left hemisphere and right hemisphere. And the two sides are connected through a bundle of nerves, which are shown in red here, the corpus callosum. So it's connecting the left and right hemispheres. Otherwise, the two sides are quite distinct. And there are patients where this structure, the corpus callosum, has been cut because they have severe epilepsy. And so this is a desperate effort to try to reduce the symptoms they feel from epilepsy. They're called split brain patients for obvious reasons. Surprisingly, they're pretty normal. They don't really exhibit the fact that the structure has been cut in everyday life. But if you do some tests, you can see that they have certain aspects to them are clearly identifiable. For example, if you get them to look at a screen and stare at a dot in the middle, the way the optical nerve is wired, anything on the right side of the visual field goes to the left hemisphere, and anything on the left visual field goes to the right hemisphere. If you flash a word, say, on the right-hand side of the screen, it goes to the left hemisphere. And then if you ask them, did you see something, they can report verbally, oh, I saw the word ring, because the speech generation area, Broca's area, is on the left-hand side of the brain. But if you flash a word on the left-hand side of the visual field, that's seen by the right hemisphere. And now if you ask them, did you see anything, they'll say, no, I didn't, because well, the left hemisphere didn't see anything. But if you ask them then, oh, can you pick up an item that corresponds with the word you've seen, they can pick up a key. Quite interesting. And then if you ask them, well, why did you pick up that key, they might report verbally, well, you know, the key goes with a ring. Perhaps they'll make up some excuse why they picked up a key. But of course, the left hemisphere has no knowledge of why they picked up a key. It's quite disconcerting that the left hemisphere is so quick to make up an excuse for behavior initiated by the right hemisphere. In fact, it reminds me of the scene from The Simpsons. And let me play it for you.
Now, sit. I said sit. Take a walk. Sniff that other dog's butt. See? He does exactly what I tell him.
Okay, so here, presumably Bart is quite conscious of the fact that he is not controlling his dog's behavior. But in fact, we might have something that's a little bit more pathetic than that. We might be making up excuses for our own behavior and not even realizing that we're doing it. And I have another clip here from a researcher. He's a neuroscientist. His name is V.S. Ramachandran. And he's talking about some of his experiments with split brain patients.
Now, many experiments have been done on these people, and I asked myself a very simple question. Okay, you've created two people here. What about their personalities? Do they have different personalities? What about their aesthetic preferences? Does one like blondes and the other like brunettes, for example? One like chocolate and the other like vanilla? What happens? So we tried these experiments, and what we did was we had to first train the right hemisphere to communicate with us. In fact, the right hemisphere can read simple commands, simple words, simple sentences. And then you ask a question and say, point to a box, yes, no, I don't know, because it can't talk. The right hemisphere cannot talk. But it can comprehend simple semantics, simple questions. Left hemisphere, of course, can talk, so you can present boxes, yes, no, I don't know. So we asked, for example, are you at Caltech? And the right hemisphere pointed to yes. Are you on the moon? It said no. Are you in California? It said yes. Are you asleep? Said no. Then I said, are you a woman? And the patient was male. And he pointed to yes, and then started chuckling and laughing. So at least the right hemisphere has a sense of humor. Okay. Okay, so now comes the big question. What if you ask, do you believe in God? So I said, do you believe in God? And the right hemisphere went straight to yes. Right? Ask the same question to the left hemisphere, yes, no, I don't know. It went to no. Right? So here's a human being whose right hemisphere is an atheist, and left hemisphere, on the other hand, believes in God. And this finding should have sent a tsunami through the theological community, but barely produced a ripple, Because it raises all kinds of profound theological questions. If this person dies, what happens? Does one him? Does one hemisphere go to heaven and the other go to hell? I don't know the answer to that.
Okay, so Ramachandran brings up a good point that the two hemispheres can actually be quite different from one another. And it's quite surprising that our own minds are like this. We don't really experience that in our conscious experience. We don't have this disunity. We have basically a unified consciousness. And it's quite surprising that this is the case, given the fact that the brain is divided into two very different hemispheres with possibly very different characteristics. Now, we've been talking about physical differences, but I want to now talk about some of the logical differences in the ways that the brain makes decisions. Some really instrumental work has been done by this man, Daniel Kahneman. He's a psychologist and professor at Princeton University, and he got the 2002 Nobel Prize in Economics for Decision Making. He wrote this book called Thinking Fast and Slow. He's advocating a model of the mind where there's two systems, and unimaginatively calls them System 1 and System 2. System 1 is the fast, intuitive, effortless system. System 2 is the slow, deliberate, rational system. You can model the mind with these two different systems, and it explains a lot. He gives this example of this test he's given to lots of university students at Harvard, MIT, and Princeton. It's called the cognitive reflection test. And the question is this, it's very simple. Say you have a bat and ball, and together they cost $1.10. The bat's worth $1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? 50% of the students gave the answer 10 cents. And you can see why. That's a very intuitive answer, right? It's a very quick answer. It probably came to you immediately when you thought of that problem. Of course, that's the wrong answer. So basically, the students that answered this incorrectly were just engaging their system one. The intuitive answer that they got off the top of their head, wrote that down and said, that's correct. But if they had spent a moment and thought about it, they would have engaged their system two and realized, that can't be right. If the ball's 10 cents, then the bat is a dollar more, that's a dollar 10, then the sum is $1.20, that's not right. They just didn't engage system two, so they got the wrong answer as a result. So that's interesting that 50% of college students who are used to answering questions like this got it wrong. Here's another question from the CRT. If it takes 5 machines 5 minutes to make 5 widgets, how long would it take 100 machines to make 100 widgets? Now this is actually even easier. It's a multiple choice question with two answers. And even so, most students got it wrong. They mostly answered 100 minutes. And if they bothered to engage system two, they would have realized that can't be right, and they would have answered 5 minutes. So that's surprising that people that are kind of lazy, they don't bother thinking about things too much. But here's something that's really amazing. If you take that same question and you make it less legible, if you reduce the font size, if you reduce the contrast, it's harder to read, more people get the right answer. Considerably more, most people get the right answer. Like, why would this be? Well, it's because people are more likely to go with their intuitive system one answer if they're at ease. Ease is sort of a sign that you can accept the intuitive answer. If you remove their sense of ease, if you make the question less legible, for example, they'll actually think about it more, and they may are more likely to come to the right answer. Think that it would be irrelevant how legible the question is, but in fact, it has a big impact. Here's another great example from the book. There's a British university that has an office kitchen, and in the office kitchen they have this price list. You can take things, items from the kitchen, and as long as you pay for them, right? You're expected to pay for them. It's an honor system, though. No one's policing it. So you're expected to drop the right amount of money into the box. And what the researchers did, without telling anyone, they just surreptitiously added some graphics to the top of the price list. 1 week they'd add a picture of flowers. The next week they'd add a graphic with eyes. And I think you see where this is going. And just to make this a little more scientific, they alternated different pictures of eyes with different pictures of flowers. And, well, not too surprisingly, the eye weeks got a lot more money in the box. And they normalized for the amount of product consumed as well. no one reported or mentioned anything about the graphic that was added. They weren't likely even conscious of it, right? It was just some decoration no one pays attention to. But this is called the priming effect, because system one is apt to notice things which maybe didn't even rise to the level of conscious awareness. And it really affects people's decisions, even if it's something that they're totally unaware of. Really amazing. There's some great experiments that have been done by this man, Dan Ariely, and he documents them in this book, Predictably Irrational, which I highly recommend. He lays out all sorts of interesting effects. And one of the experiments he describes is asking his students which magazine subscription they would prefer. He gave three options. He said, oh, you can have the magazine online only, on the internet, for $59. Or you could have a print version of the magazine for $125. Or you could have both, print and internet, for $125 as well. And so his 100 students basically preferred the option three, the print and internet version of the magazine. None of them took the print-only version because, well, why would you? It's the same price and you get less. So not surprising there. But here's the thing. What if he eliminated that option that no one chose? Took away the print-only option. No one chose it. It shouldn't have any effect, right? Actually, it did have a great effect. In fact, when he ran this experiment with different people, he found that by eliminating that option, now most of them preferred option one. Totally irrational, right? Why would eliminating an option that no one chose affect the results? And it did. And the explanation here is because there's an easy comparison between option two and three. If system one can make that comparison very easily, option three is obviously superior to option two. So because there's an obviously superior choice between those two, it actually makes it seem like option three is better overall. And when you eliminated that, what they call decoy option, now all of a sudden people thought about it more and they switched their preference, because by thinking about it more, they switched their preference. So be on the lookout for advertisements that have this form, because they might be trying to take advantage of this effect. Amazing that this would happen. Something that shouldn't have an effect often does have an effect because of this. We often make decisions for reasons that we're not consciously aware of. Now, I've been really hard on system one, advocating that most of the time system two gets the right answer. But there are cases where we really should pay attention to system one. And Malcolm Gladwell has a book called Blink, where he talks about how experts often should rely on their system one. And this isn't Malcolm Gladwell. This is a Roman statue purchased by the Getty Museum in California in 1986. And after 14 months of careful analysis, they decided, oh, this is authentic. We'll spend $7 million buying this statue. But then they showed it to various experts, and to their horror, the experts, within seconds of seeing it, said, oh, that's a fake. And they couldn't really articulate why it was a fake, but you know, it's likely to be a fake, because these experts basically built up a lot of System 1 expertise, seeing hundreds or thousands of statues. And even though they couldn't articulate why they thought it was a fake, they were able to make an accurate judgment within seconds because of the fact that they had a lot of intuitive knowledge about what real statues or authentic statues should be like. So if you're an expert, you might in fact come to a better decision relying on System 1 than you would if you were to try to engage System 2. Because unfortunately, System 1, even though it gives us these judgments, it doesn't show its work. You don't consciously have awareness about what System 1 is doing when it's giving this input. Another example is chess masters. When a chess master plays a game against, say, dozens of people all at once, he's moving very rapidly. He looks at the chessboard and makes a move within seconds. He's using System 1 there, because there's no way he could cognitively make a move within seconds. He's just looking at the chessboard, seeing what to him looks like a good move, and he's likely to win all those games because he's got a finely tuned System 1 after playing thousands and thousands of games of chess. Now I want to switch to another topic, cognitive dissonance. And there's a great book by Carol Tavris that details this. It's called Mistakes Were Made, But Not By Me. She has some great examples. Oh, cognitive dissonance is the discomfort one feels when one tries to hold two ideas that are mutually incompatible. It's an attempt to try to achieve some level of integration between ideas. So it's generally a good thing, but it has some bad effects, unfortunately. She gives this really good example in her book of two different students who have exactly the same opinion about cheating. They both think cheating is not a good thing, but there are worse crimes in the world. So they have a moderate opinion about cheating. They're basically identical. But they're faced with a situation where they're taking a test, they're doing really badly, they're in danger of failing, and they both have an opportunity to cheat. And at that moment, one of them impulsively decides to cheat, and the other one impulsively decides not to cheat. And now that they've committed this action, they have to justify it. There's a strong drive to justify what you've done. You know, the one that has cheated now has to live with the fact that their self-conception might be damaged by this, versus the one that has decided not to cheat, well, now they're accepting a lower mark. They both have to pay a price for their decision. So if you ask these students now, a week after they've taken the test, you know, what's your opinion of cheating? The one who cheated might say, hey, everyone cheats, it's no big deal. Versus the one who decided not to cheat might say something like, oh, people who cheat are disgraceful and should be expelled. So now, even though they both initially had moderate opinions about cheating, they've become polarized because of the need to justify their actions. These two students could have switched places. If the one who impulsively decided to cheat decided not to cheat, and vice versa, they would have ended up with their polar opinions swapped. Because of this, I wonder how many strongly held opinions I have that maybe are a result of trying to justify some action I've taken in the past. This even happens retroactively, in that if you ask these students, have you always felt that way about cheating? They might say, yes, I've always felt that cheating is a horrible thing. And basically, they're rewriting history to lessen the sense of cognitive dissonance. Here's another great example. This actually is from work in the 50s. If you have a group that has an initiation ceremony, and there's some people that experience a severe initiation, and others that have a mild initiation to enter the group, the ones that have a severe initiation, if you ask them, they report that they're more satisfied with the group. They like the group more. And it's because of a need to justify. They've had to suffer the severe initiation. Now they report that they're more satisfied because they're trying to rationalize their decision. You know, we don't have any initiation ceremony for the Ottawa Skeptics, but maybe we should start. Just to raise everyone's satisfaction level. And you can see this is where fraternity hazing comes from, and maybe even stores that charge for membership for you to join, that kind of thing. Now, as skeptics, we really have to pay attention, I think, to cognitive dissonance, because often the mutually incompatible ideas are something like this. Everyone believes some form of this. I am a smart, ethical, and competent person. Who doesn't believe that? If you make a mistake, or if you're shown to have done something that's somewhat foolish, that's evidence supporting this other idea. I invested money, time, and effort in something that was useless, foolish, or hurtful. And so these are the two ideas that are often in conflict. And so as skeptics, we often are presenting evidence to people that might support the second hypothesis. And people are naturally resistant to this because of cognitive dissonance. In fact, if you force them to choose between these, they're most likely to choose the first option. And who wouldn't, really? It's natural. So we basically, as skeptics, we have to avoid the case where we're forcing people into this state of cognitive dissonance, and because they're going to reject your evidence, they're going to stop listening to you as a result. Of course, we also have to be on guard for doing this ourselves. We have to not reject evidence that says we're wrong because we're trying to defend ourselves. The position I think that is sensible to avoid this is to say something like this: I'm a smart, ethical, and competent person. I admit when I am wrong, take responsibility for my actions, and avoid repeating errors. By doing this, you can take pride in making mistakes. I think this is the way to get out of the cognitive dissonance problem as skeptics. So this is my last topic. I think it's a very important one, though. Emotion and rationality. Because a lot of people have this concept that somehow emotion is irrational. I think I want to clarify that. First, I want to give a definition for rationality, though. There's two types. The first type is epistemic rationality, and that's a method of obtaining an accurate view of reality. So this, as skeptics, this is something that we often are advocating. We want people to have an accurate view of reality. But there's another type of rationality, instrumental rationality. And this is the method of achieving your goals, whatever they are. Now, this doesn't define what the goals are, right? It could be anything. It could be kill all humans. There's rational and less rational ways of going about that. It may be unrealistic, it might be immoral, but there's still, it isn't irrational. There's just less and more rational ways of attempting to achieve that goal. Now, I want to use this as an example of topic of emotion and rationality. This beloved character, Mr. Spock, from the original Star Trek series, he's a half-Vulcan. Vulcans are supposed to be not emotionless, but rather they're supposed to control their emotions. And his character on Star Trek often, I think, is sort of a mischaracterization of rationality. And there's a great presentation by Julie Galef where she calls this straw Vulcan rationality. And this is in reference to you've heard of the straw man argument. That's when you misrepresent your opponent's position, you caricature it, and this is an effort to make it easier to defeat. Same thing here. Straw Vulcan rationality is a mischaracterization of rationality in an effort to undermine it, because there's so many episodes where it's shown that Spock's hyper-rationality just doesn't work. According to the Star Trek lore, being rational means expecting other people to be rational too, and here's an example of that. There's an Enterprise shuttle that's crash-landed on a planet. The crew members are being attacked by the indigenous population, and McCoy has some criticism of Mr. Spock's commands.
Well, Mr. Spock, they didn't stay frightened very long, did they?
Most illogical reaction. When we demonstrated our superior weapons, they should have fled.
You mean they should have respected us?
Of course.
Mr. Spock, respect is a rational process. Did it ever occur to you they might react emotionally? With anger?
Doctor, I'm not responsible for their unpredictability.
They were perfectly predictable. To anyone with feeling. You might as well admit it, Mr. Spock. Your precious logic brought them down on us.
So that's a good example of apparently being rational means you're going to make bad decisions. But really, this is an example of Spock not being epistemically rational. Despite the evidence to the contrary, he's made the assumption that the inhabitants of this planet are rational, and that's a bad idea. So really, this is not a misrepresentation of rationality. He's not being epistemically rational. Here's another example of this. Being rational means never relying on intuition. Here's a scene where Spock and Kirk are playing chess.
I'd call it a pretty long reach for evidence, Mr. Spock. Come in, Charlie.
And again. Check.
Checkmate.
Your illogical approach to chess does have its advantages on occasion, Captain.
Instrumental rationality is trying to achieve your goals, and presumably they both have the goal of winning the chess game. So clearly, Kirk here is being more instrumentally rational than Spock. If you do win the chess game, whatever method you use is by definition more rational than the other method. So this is another mischaracterization of rationality. I think you can model the type of emotion, the interrelationship between emotion and rationality portrayed in Star Trek is sort of like this. You have a goal, and instrumental rationality lets you achieve that goal by deciding on appropriate actions. But emotion gets in the way, and therefore you should squelch emotion because it's just interfering with your ability to make good choices. And so that's not necessarily wrong. You can think of examples where people who have strong emotions like anger, or if they're depressed or jealous, that they're going to potentially make choices which are not in their own best interest. But really, this is quite incomplete. This is a very impoverished version of the interplay between emotion and reason. Because if you think about it, how do you decide between two possible outcomes? When you're trying to select what a good action is, how do you judge what is a good outcome and what's a bad outcome? If you just employ rational means, there's no way of deciding between two things. Even if they're incredibly different, there's really no good way of saying, well, from a rational perspective, each one of them is equally good. There's no way of deciding between them. Then that's where emotion comes in. It's the way that we judge what's a good and what's a bad outcome. It gives us a way of generating goals. Before, we just had no way. The goals were just a given. But here, we understand that goals are something that are generated from emotional desires. So far from being something that just interferes with our decision-making, emotions really are key to generating those goals and judging whether the outcomes are good or bad. So we can't hope to eliminate emotion and still come up with good decisions. In particular, people who have certain types of brain injury, who are unable to pay attention to the emotions they feel regarding thoughts they have, are really crippled in this respect. They can't make judgments. They're given two options and they spend forever trying to choose between them because they don't get enough feedback from their emotional system to make the decision between the two. The takeaway message from this is that emotions are important for our judgments, and it would be folly to try to reduce emotions in order to make better judgments. To summarize, why is metacognition something important to us as skeptics particularly? Well, it's the key to so many things. It's the key to how we can understand others. If we can model the way they think, we can understand why they act the way they do. And also, it's something that's important if we want to try to influence people effectively. You don't want to force them into a situation of cognitive dissonance in particular. We want metacognition so we can understand ourselves and to make better decisions. In particular, we want to understand those types of errors that people typically make and not make them. So it's really ultimately to improve ourselves that we want to engage in metacognition and why it's important. So to borrow Darren's catchphrase from the Reality Check podcast, I think to sum up, we want to think better to act better. Thank you very much.